Okay, coming back to history now, in 1852, we had the first airship flown by Henry Giffard. And no prizes for guessing what kind of engine he has used, because we can see steam coming out. So, although IC engine was available, but Giffard's first airship was basically a steam engine airship, and it was in France. So, Henry Giffard is considered to be the pioneer in airship technology. So, it had a control system, which you can see there is a sail on the right hand side. It had an envelope which contained the lighter than gas and a propulsion system. So, the three things that you require are buoyant lift, which is through the balloon, control system to fight the winds and go in the desired direction, and the propulsive device to enable you to fight the wind. So, all three were present for the first time in Henry Giffard's airship. Okay, then this technology traveled to Australia, and there were other people who made balloon flights in Australia, but not the airship. This is still balloon. Okay, and then we saw the military use of balloons in the Franco-Prussian War. There was a war between Prussia and France, and in that war, for the first time in ancient times, the Chinese did not use it for an offensive purpose. They used it for only indicating and marking where their troops are, etc. But this is the first offensive use of the LTS systems in any war or military environment. Okay, moving on, Henry Giffard, who made the first airship, kept on working further in this technology, and he realized that this technology can be used for tourism. Because at that time, people were struggling to get airborne. Okay, this is much before 1903 when Wright brothers flew. This is 1878. So, the aerospace technology at that time was driven by developments in LTA systems. Aircraft were nowhere to be seen. They were only being conceived and planned. Maybe there were gliders, etc. during this time, but no aircraft. But airships, aerostats, as you can see, people are already planning to use aerostats for tourism purposes. That means they are sufficiently confident that they can carry tourists, not adventurers, but tourists, people like you and me, common man, aam aadmi. They can be taken into an aerostat and float around. Okay, and this is the man, Count Ferdinand August Graf von Zeppelin. The word Graf is the German for count. He is the person who should be credited for the massive increase in the technological levels of airships. And it's one thing to invent something, it's the other to take it to the commercial and professional level. So, he is the person who has done this. He was a count in Germany, and his contribution to airship technology is very phenomenal. So, as a mark of respect, what we do is, so he built the first rigid airship in 1900, before Wright brothers. The world's first rigid airship was built by Count Ferdinand von Zeppelin. It was called as the Luftschiff-Zeppelin 1 or LZ-1, LZ-1. Luftschiff is airship in German, and Zeppelin is the name of the count. So much is the contribution of this gentleman that all rigid airships are generally called as Zeppelins. Okay, it's like Xerox, which has become a name for photocopying machines. So, his name is synonymous with rigid airships, and airships at that time were mostly rigid, because the technological developments in fabrics were not so advanced that they could think of having a load carrying member, as well as a gas barrier, as well as something that can withstand the atmospheric conditions. Of course, they had these gas bags for balloons, etc., or aerostats, but for sustained flight over long distances, they were not able to do it only using an airbag or only using a textile fabric, which can be done now. So, therefore, all airships at that time were generally rigid airships. And the Europeans, you know, there are many countries in Europe during that time who were able to use this technology and who were able to give us airships. Okay. And also the technology has also moved to USA. So USA was not the leader in this technology. They got it actually from the people who went, okay, Jean-Pierre Blanchard, who went to US. He took the technology with him to the US. So this is Graf Zeppelin's first airship, LZ-1, and I just want to share with you some information and some dimensions about this airship. So it's 420 feet or 128 meters long and 11.73 meters dia. Okay. So the length over diameter ratio is just slightly more than 11, that is the L by D. Okay. The volume is, if you go in square feet, is almost 400,000 square feet. But we normally work in the SI units, so it's 11,298 meter cube. This is a mistake. I have to correct this mistake. The maximum speed is just 7.5 meters per second. Okay. So it is going to fight the winds, but only to the extent of 7.5 meters per second. If the oncoming wind is more than this, it is just going to remain where it is. Slow moving vehicle, but ability to travel large distances. Okay, now with this, airships became more and more popular, more and more capable. And Santos Dumont is a Brazilian, and many Brazilians feel that he should be credited with the first airship, because they claim that he was actually able to make an airship and fly before Henry Giffard. But probably there is no record or no documentation, and that's why the claim is not that much acceptable in historical literature. But that's a matter of historical debate. Interestingly, he was the person who showed that they are very capable and they are able to do things. Now, at that point of time in 1901, when you say capable, you have to look at the competition, which is only the automobiles and the ships. So 7.5 meter per second is not a huge performance, at least speed wise. But look at the time, it's 1901. So here is a man who is able to fly around the Eiffel Tower in 30 minutes using an airship. And with this demonstration, a lot of popularity of airships spread all over Europe. The internet is full of videos of people running and, you know, looking around where the airships are and pointing towards them in the sky and showing excitement about it. So they became very common across Europe and Asia, USA, and they were being used many, many places in large numbers, because this was the best thing available at that time. Okay, Russians will come later. Now, the Graf Zeppelin LZ-1 was then upgraded or improved to make the another one. Now, what is the upgradation? The upgradation is coming in terms of this particular control system that you see here in the front as well as in the back. So, the second one lifts off in 1906. In between, we had the Wright brothers, and the Germany became the largest maker of rigid and semi-rigid airships and balloons. So they realized that there is also some merit in making semi-rigid. There is no need to make the whole thing completely rigid. You could have a semi-rigid structure, which, as you know, contains a framework inside with a flexible covering or flexible envelope. In a rigid airship, everything is rigid. The gas bags are inside, but the structure, the framework is rigid, the covering is also rigid. All right. So then Italy is not lagging behind. Italy also succeeds in having their own airship. And you can notice they have used a very interesting system to give you directional. So they have used louvre system mounted behind the airship, assuming that as the airship goes forward, the vertical louvres will deflect and give you the direct side force. Okay, right. So then now we have the first situation in which you can have the crossing of the Atlantic. That was the next challenge for people. That happened in 1910 when an airship flew across the Atlantic. Now, you can imagine how much time it took. The speeds would not be very high, and you will be fighting the winds also. The winds in the ocean are quite high, or can be quite high. So I would request someone to find out about this particular flight, the first Atlantic crossing by an airship called America. We want to know more details. What was the propulsive system? What was the maximum speed? So on the Moodle page, you can give us some information about this particular airship. Okay. Russia is not lagging behind again, and they also acquire airships from Europe for military purposes. And then France and Spain, they got together, and there was a Franco-Spanish production of Astra Torres airships. As you can see now, some amount of aerodynamic shaping is coming into the design. But there is a complete delinking between the gondola or the passenger carrying dolly and the envelope. So we see that people are being suspended on through ropes below the envelope. You will see slowly as things evolve. Let's see how many people. So all over the world, these were the places where airship operators and manufacturers were available. In 1911, there were so many places in the world. Where, so you can see that the concentration is in Europe. There are these five stars in Europe. There is one in Russia, one in US, and one in Australia. This is where the technology. The most of the work was done in Germany, France, UK, and in Italy also. Correct, Italy, Spain. These are the places where. Now that was the first period, and then we had the First World War.